Thank you very much for this introduction, and I'm also very grateful to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak here. So this is joint work with Nilanjana Datta, and maybe the best thing is if I immediately go to my first points here. So these are the two questions we want to answer in this talk. The first question is, how fast do infinite dimensional quantum systems evolve? So you have an initial state and you specify a time, and then you ask how far can you get from this initial state in a certain time interval? And the other question that we try to answer is, do entropies and capacities in infinite dimensions satisfy continuity bounds? And if they do, then the question is, what is the rate of convergence? So if we have the entropy of a state one and the entropy of a state two, we look at their difference. And can we bound that in terms of the difference of the states? And if we can, then the question is, okay, what kind of convergence do we expect? Do we expect like quadratic or linear convergence or whatever? And so this is about infinite dimensions, and I would also like to emphasize maybe on my first slide why we look at infinite dimensions and not at finite dimensional systems. So in finite dimensional systems, it turns out that these questions are very easy to answer. So you have, to answer the first question, so how far can you go in a certain time interval? We see that if we take a state psi t and a state psi zero, so psi t is the solution to a Schrödinger equation with a Hamiltonian H. So all constants in this talk will be equal to one. And so we see that the difference of this state minus this state can be written in that way, expressed through this integral. And if we differentiate this integral, we get down the Hamiltonian. It will act on our initial state. And since the evolution is unitary, this will vanish because of the norm. And this integral will provide us another factor t. So we see that this difference here is bounded by the Hamiltonian acting on psi zero times t. And so since states have a unit norm, we can bound this by the operator norm of h times t. And so, So from this simple computation, we conclude that systems with bounded Hamiltonian evolve linearly in time, right? So if you have a finite dimensional system, your Hamiltonian is automatically bounded, and so you can evolve at most. So the rate at which you evolve away from your initial state will be linear in time. Now, in infinite dimensions, it's no longer necessarily true that your Hamiltonian is bounded. So this operator norm at the end would be infinite, and so it would a priori not be clear what to expect there. And so A similar thing is true for the entropies. So we have two states in CD, and they satisfy a certain distance constraint. Then, if we introduce here the binary entropy, then we get for the von Neumann entropy the following bound. So the von Neumann entropy of one state minus the von Neumann entropy of the other state is bounded just in terms of quantities that depend on the density matrices, namely the one norm here, and then log of the dimension minus one, plus the binary entropy of our difference. Now, the thing also to notice here is that this bound, it depends explicitly on the dimension. So in infinite dimensions, you would expect, if you assume that this was the way to go, then in infinite dimensions, the log of the dimension would go to infinity. And so you would not expect such a bound maybe to hold. And so in finite dimensions, these two simple statements give you a full picture of what is going on, but in infinite dimensions, one has to understand a bit more about the intrinsic properties of your system. So let me now talk about these questions in infinite dimensions. So we fix now a closed quantum system. So it's again, the evolution is again but described by the Schrödinger equation. And then we ask the following question. So is there a continuous function C of t such that psi of t, so this is the time evolved state minus the initial state, is bounded by this function c of t, and c of t has now the property that it goes to zero as time goes to zero. So certainly this is true as its status here, because you know time evolution in quantum mechanics is continuous. So if you go with your time back to zero, you will certain psi of t will certainly converge to psi of zero, and this is true. But now the requirement that we have is, we don't want to make a statement that depends on every initial state, but we want to have a statement that is uniform in the initial state. So we ask the question, does this hold for all psi of zero? So can we find a function such that this holds for all psi zero? And so on the last slide, we saw in finite dimensions, we can, because then the Hamiltonian is bounded. And we had this, so we derived this upper bound that the difference here is bounded by the Hamiltonian times t. Okay, but now the question is what goes in infinite dimensions, and there's actually a very simple example that shows that in infinite dimensions you cannot expect something like that. So we look at the simplest operator that you can imagine, the harmonic oscillator, so it's written here with the creation annihilation operators and the number operator. It comes with an eigenbasis n. We look at, so the initial state to our Schrödinger equation is just the eigenstate n, then we know exactly what the time evolved state is, it's just e to the minus the eigenvalue times t. And now we look at this difference here, and of course if we plug in this expression here for this psi of t, we get that expression. And now you see the problem is that certainly if we let t go to zero, we will converge to one here, but we ask for uniformity, and we see that the problem is that if we now look at times t, which are pi over n plus a half, if we plug them in here, the difference will be always two, right? So these states are always orthogonal at these times t equal to pi over n plus a half. So what this means is that since we can let n go to infinity, we ask for uniformity, so we can consider any eigenstate. It means that for arbitrarily short times, your system can always evolve into a state that is orthogonal to the initial state, right? Okay. And so the problem seems to come from the high energy states, because it's exactly that the large n is the problem here. And so if we let n go to infinity, then we get to arbitrarily small times. So it's exactly from the unboundedness of the initial Hamiltonian, because this one has spectrum up to infinity. Okay. Sorry. Now, in order to say something about quantum dynamics, we have to introduce a sort of a global framework to study these questions. And this is in terms of semigroups. So let me briefly introduce the framework I want to use. So I denote by this peculiar d of h here the density operators on Hilbert space h. Then I look at CPTP maps t from the density operators into the density operators. And these are, in my notation, or in my convention, the quantum channels. And now a quantum system, no matter whether it's closed or open, it's described in terms of a family of these CPTP maps, which composes then the semigroup. So the quantum dynamics so consists of these operators here, lambda of t, they take density matrices and maps the initial state to the density matrix at time t. So this can be an open or a closed quantum system. They will always be CTPT maps. And so these operators here, they satisfy semigroup properties, which is that at the initial state, you recover your, at time zero, you recover your initial state. At time t plus s, so if you first go to time t and then go from time t to time s, that's the same as if you go from t immediately up to time t plus, so from zero to immediately to t plus s, and they satisfy a certain contractivity property, which is written here. Okay, and for these semigroups, we define the generator lambda of rho, L of rho, as the derivative at zero of the semigroup. This one might not, in infinite dimensions, not clear that this exists for every state, but it will exist for a dense set of states, and so it's only defined on these particular states. Now, the following is true, which is a bit what we just already saw, that if your generator is bounded, so for example, if you have a bounded Hamiltonian, then the semigroup is uniformly continuous. So it means that we first take the soup of all possible states we can consider, and then let the time t go to zero, then this will go to zero. And if the generator, or in the simplest case of a closed quantum system, the Hamiltonian is unbounded, then this is only true pointwise, right? So for each density matrix, we know that we will converge if we let the time go to zero, but it's not necessarily uniformly true. So this is just saying that quantum evolution is continuous. Okay, so a simple example to fix notation. So if I have a closed quantum system, then the evolution is given by the by this semigroup here, and this one has a generator, which is just given by this commutator here with the Hamiltonian, which is known as the von Neumann equation. Okay, so now to study how far can you evolve, you need a certain distance measure on these kind of quantum channels, or for what we are aiming at for the semigroup, right? So we need to put up a norm on the space of quantum channels. And a very canonical norm, because these are CPTP maps, is the Diamond norm. So the Diamond norm is, since by the complete positivity, you take here the tensor product with the identity on finite dimensional spaces, and then since it's trace preserving map, you look at the trace norm, which I indicate here by this one. And so you take the soup of all possible states in this tensor product space and take then the soup of all dimensions that are possible, so all finite dimensions. And this just accounts for the CPTP character of these maps. So this is the canonical norm. But again, it turns out that similar to our harmonic oscillator example, that this norm is also far too strong to measure any kind of quantum evolution. And because you see, you take again here all the states into account, right? You're not looking at particular states, but you're looking at all the states, and then it's too large. Like we initially wanted to have this uniform bound in the initial state in the harmonic oscillator. Okay, and the example here is that if you look at the attenuation channel, then it's defined by this action on coherent states because they span the entire set of density operators, basically, can be written as a linear combination of these guys. And then it turns out that, so this computation is actually done in a paper by Winter, that if you look at times t that are not equal to s, so if you look at two different times, then this difference is always equal to 2, right? So you do not really measure with that norm that, you know, at a small time interval, you do not evolve that far away from your initial state because it's always 2, right? So you do not capture anything here. Okay, now to account for this high energy states, we saw that these were the problems in the case of the harmonic oscillator. We define, so this has actually been defined in previous work, and the relevant people are listed here. There's a certain notion of an energy constraint Diamond norm. So this energy constraint Diamond norm takes now exactly care of the problem that these high energy states are the bad guys, so to say. So it comes now with another operator S. So this is just a positive operator. The spectrum is positive. That's what I mean by saying that S is positive. And then the energy constraint Diamond norm is introduced, so it comes with a parameter E. It has to be above the bottom of the spectrum of S. And then you only consider those states. So before that, we had here the supremum of all states. Now we consider only those states whose expectation, so if we trace out the CN space, whose expectation, so if this was the Hamiltonian, it would be the expected energy. And so we only look at those states that have an energy less than E. Right, so this should take care of the high energy states. And so for our purpose, it was actually, it seemed actually useful to look at an alpha ECD norm where alpha is now a parameter between 0 and 1. So we don't consider only the like S, but we consider also other moments. So if alpha is equal to 1, then you would have a power 2 here. And if it goes to 0, you would almost approximate the identity. And so the energy constraint Diamond norm that was introduced here is then given for alpha 1/2. Okay, now, in order to get a bit familiar with this energy constraint Diamond norm, let us mention a few properties that it has. So the energy constraint Diamond norm, well, it first defines a norm. So if if the Diamond norm is 0, then your T is also 0. It's increasing in the energy parameter because if you consider only those states that have energy less than E, and now you consider all the states that have less than energy that's larger than energy E, well, then you're looking at a larger set, and so your norm will also increase. But the nice thing is that, you know, similar to finite dimensional systems, you know, in finite dimensions, all norms are equivalent. So it's actually true here that for a given alpha parameter, it doesn't really matter which parameter E you take, as long as it's above the bottom of the spectrum, because these norms are actually equivalent. So you also get a reverse inequality. And in the limit as E goes to infinity, the standard Diamond norm is actually recovered from these energy constraint Diamond norms, because then you basically have no energy constraint at all. Okay. And the last property is maybe to relate a bit how does it depend on this parameter alpha. So if you take alpha smaller than beta, then you see having like a second moment is a stronger constraint than having only a first moment. So if you take a larger beta, then that's a stronger constraint. So your Diamond norm here is less than your Diamond norm alpha if alpha is smaller than beta. Okay, and now let us mention some results on the dynamics of closed quantum systems to get a bit familiar with this. So now we look at the Schrödinger equation and we express its solution well, so it can be written, so the solution to the Schrödinger equation can of course be written also in terms of such a semigroup, and then we get the following results. So for states phi, so these phi's zeros, so these initial states are now such that this expression actually makes sense. So our Hamiltonian, the absolute value of our Hamiltonian to the power alpha, phi zero. So for all such states, so previously when we introduced these diamond norms, we had an energy constraint, and so this would correspond to that this expectation value is less than E alpha. So for all states that have expectation less than E alpha, let's say, we have that the distance between the semigroup at time t and the distance between the semigroup at time s is bounded by a constant g alpha, this energy constraint, and then t minus s to the power alpha. Okay, so this actually gives us now a continuity bound even for systems, so even for infinite dimensional systems. But because we do not look at all states where we would not get such a bound, but we look only at those states such that this object here is finite. Oh, sorry. And so here I plotted this prefactor. So you remember that, you know, I said so in the beginning we had, if your Hamiltonian is bounded, then you have like, then you have this bound and you have just the Hamiltonian acting on your phi zero times t minus s. And so in that case, you see that if alpha is equal to one, you exactly recover the one, which was the bound on the first slide. So, but in any case, so this gives you now a continuity bound even in infinite dimensional systems. And we can also extend it a bit we still look at closed quantum systems, but now we look at the solutions to the von Neumann equation. And there was a previous bound by Winter that the difference between those in the energy constraint diamond norm is bounded by 4e to the power t minus s to the power 1/3. And so we actually find now, with the techniques that we use, we found a somewhat different bound. So let me write it first here in great generality, because we have these alpha energy constraint diamond norms. So if you look at the semigroup for the von Neumann equation, then the difference between the semigroup at time t and the semigroup at time s is bounded by 2 times g alpha. G alpha was the constant that appeared on the slide before, e to the power alpha. So because we are looking at only those states that have energy less than alpha, energy less than e, t minus s to the power alpha. Okay. And now when we specialize this for alpha half, then we are in the same setting as Winter here. So we look at the energy constraint diamond norm, where we really constrain the energy with our Hamiltonian H. Then we find a somewhat better behavior, namely that we have t minus s to the power half, right? So you have to see these bounds are particularly useful for short times, and t to the power 1/3, as you get here, means that you can evolve further away from your initial state than if you only have t to the power 1/2. And so this gives you a stronger constraint on how far states from a time s to time t can evolve. Okay, so I should say that we always constrain the energy here with the Hamiltonian of our system. So for closed quantum system, there's a natural candidate to test, you know, to measure the energy, which is the Hamiltonian itself. For open quantum systems, it may not be so obvious, but here it's very obvious with a Hamiltonian, and we take the absolute value because we had a requirement that the operator, which was then called S in the energy constraint diamond norm, has to be positive. So that's why we look at the absolute value of the Hamiltonian. Okay, so now we look at open quantum systems. That's a bit of new territory. So open quantum systems for unbounded generators, this has been introduced in the 70s by Davis. And we still look at generators that are of the Lindblad or the GKLS type form. But now in the unbounded setting, and the rigorous framework behind that was actually provided by Davis. Okay, and we get a similar result for these open systems as we got for the closed systems, namely that, for these open quantum systems, these are the Lindblad operators, and then we have a Hamiltonian in our system, and now there are two candidates that we can sort of naturally use to measure the energy, either the Hamiltonian, But there are examples of channels like the attenuation channel that was presenting that don't have a Hamiltonian part. In that case, there's another natural candidate which is given by the Lindblad operator. So this is this K here. It's a negative operator. It appears in the generator, and it's negative because you have L star L. So the absolute value of K is then just this with the plus sign. So the Hamiltonian, so the absolute value of the Hamiltonian and the absolute value of this K, they are two very natural operators, self-adjoint operators that appear for open quantum systems that you can use to constrain the energy with. And then we get similar bounds for the evolution of an open quantum system. So there's a requirement here that I'm hiding in my slides. So you either need that K is relatively H-bounded, which means that H should be sort of the dominant part in your quantum evolution, or the other way around, that H is maybe relatively K-bounded. For example, for this attenuation channel, you don't have a Hamiltonian part, so it's zero. So that might be a scenario that you would consider then. So in both cases, we get a bound, which is you have the 2 alpha norm here. You constrain with either the Hamiltonian, or you constrain with the operator K, and you get a sort of similar behavior in terms of the energy parameter that you use to penalize the energy moments, and the T minus S to the power alpha. Okay, so also open quantum systems can be treated with that framework. At least the ones we were looking at, which are the all systems of GKLS type 4, which is, I guess, a quite large class. Okay, so let us give an example now of this. So we look at quantum Brownian motion. So as a Hamiltonian, we take the harmonic oscillator, and for the Lindblad type operators, we take the creation and annihilation operators. And well, if you write down now the GKLS equation, then you will end up with something like that, where you have diffusion constants, which is basically why it's called a quantum Brownian motion, because your particle is evolving in a diffusive way, and these are the constants. So you can consider a bit more interesting case when you don't have like only a parameter gamma, but you have, let's say, several of those, so several Lindblad operators and with different parameters in front of the differential and the multiplication operator. But I now looked at a very simple case just to illustrate this. So, So now you look at this operator K that I defined before. We said that either K has to be relatively H-bounded or the other way around. Well, now we see that K is basically something similar to the Hamiltonian, which means it is actually relatively H-bounded. And then in this energy constraint Diamond norm, our energy parameter had to be above the bottom of the spectrum with respect to that operator that we're using to penalize the energy with. If that's the Hamiltonian, so that this one is already positive because it's a harmonic oscillator, we don't have to take an absolute value here. The infimum of its spectrum is a half, and so we actually get such a rate of convergence for the quantum Brownian motion. Okay, so there's a vast zoo of other examples, like the attenuation and amplification channel to which our theory applies, the various models from quantum optics, the quantum Boltzmann equation, which describes the motion of a particle in a let's say in a plasma maybe, and many more. But another area of interest are quantum speed limits. So quantum speed limits, to explain to you, this area deals with the question, how long does it take to evolve from one state to a state that is orthogonal to the initial state? And so in finite dimensions, this has been answered in this work here. And it says that the minimal time, so you have an initial state, you want to know what is the minimal time it takes until you evolve to the to a state orthogonal to it, then this is the minimal time that you need is bounded by the maximum of pi over 2 of, now this delta E is the variance, so the energy variance of your initial state, and this pi over 2 times E, so where E is now the expected energy of your initial state. So this is for a closed quantum system with a Hamiltonian, and that defines these two objects, and then this is the minimal time that you need. Okay, so now the point is that for an infinite dimensional system, the expected energy doesn't even have to exist. So that's, for example, an area where we can now, with our bounds, if we rearrange them basically only, then we get other bounds. So if we look at the relative angle theta between your initial state and your time evolved state, and we want to know, okay, what is the minimal time you need to evolve from one state theta phi zero to a state phi t, so that the angle is, let's say, I don't know, pi over three. Then you can plug this into this equation and you get a minimal time. And where sort of our results outperform the previous ones is that since we have these alpha energy constraint Diamond norms, we can also consider moments that are, so of when we look at the expected energies, Hamiltonian applied to rho, right? But now we could also look at Hamiltonian to the power half times rho, and where Hamiltonian times rho might be infinite, the trace of that, Hamiltonian to the power half times rho might be finite, and then we get actually a better bound than, that's an obvious case when this bound has to be better than that one, because that one is infinite. And so, since our bounds look very similar for closed and open quantum systems, we also get something similar for open systems and relative burst angles. So I've written down here what I mean by that, since I realized there are different definitions out there. So if you have such an angle theta that you specify, then you get a lower bound on the minimal time that you need to evolve from your rho zero to rho t, and such that the burst angle is your specified theta. And this parameter omega is what appeared in these open quantum systems, and here you have to specify either whether this k was relatively h-bounded or the other way around. Okay, so the main tool that we use to study these questions are so-called Favart spaces. So so these are spaces consisting of all the x and x, such that the supremum of all t of your semigroup, so you evolve, let's say, a state up to time t, you subtract the initial state, and then you take 1 over t to the power alpha. If that is finite, then you say x belongs to the alpha Favart space. Rearranging that says that, you know, the distance of lambda t x minus x is bounded by some constant times t to the power alpha. So that is how we end up with this t to the power alpha bounds. But now the question is how to link this with these energy constraints that we have in these Diamond norms. Well, the answer is that you can reformulate the condition that x is in f alpha by a condition on the generator of the semigroup. And so if you have like a closed quantum system, then your generator contains the Hamiltonian, and that's basically how we link this time evolution to something related by the generator. And in fact, this concept of Favart spaces is far more general than quantum evolution. It applies to any contractive semigroup, whereby contractive I mean that this property is satisfied. Okay, let me now talk about entropy bounds and entropies in infinite dimensions. So that's the second part. So we had in finite dimensions, we had such a nice continuity bound, where the question is what happens in infinite dimensions, and there's a very negative result by Weyl from the 70s, which says that, so you take a state rho, you take an arbitrarily small epsilon, then you will always find a state rho triddle, such that, so this would be the trace distance between rho and rho triddle is less than epsilon, but no matter what the entropy of the state S rho is, the entropy of S rho triddle will be infinite, right? So it's very, it's kind of different, you know, from this scenario, because here, if these are epsilon apart, then you have a very strong constraint on what the entropy of your second state can be. And so here, continuity fails quite dramatically in infinite dimensions. So how can we prove continuity bounds if the entropy is infinite? Well, so there's a result by Winter from 2015, which has three assumptions under which, so I mean, if something doesn't hold, then the question is, can you impose assumptions so that it holds? So the assumption is that this state exists, it's called the Gibbs state, it's e to the minus beta times your Hamiltonian. If this is a trace class operator, roughly speaking, it already requires that H has a point spectrum. So like if you have just a Laplacian, for example, then this would not be true, but for the harmonic oscillator, it works. This is called the Gibbs hypothesis. If your two states, if they both satisfy an energy constraint with respect to that Hamiltonian, and if they are not too far apart, then you get a continuity bound for the entropy. So S of rho minus S of sigma is bounded by 2 times epsilon, this epsilon is coming from this distance constraint here, times the entropy of this Gibbs state, right? So there's one canonical state, or one special state, the Gibbs state, that appears in these inequalities, and that's used to bound the difference of these entropies. And then this H epsilon is the binary entropy we saw on the first page. And so now the question is, of course, if the distance between these two goes to zero, does this also go to zero? The entropies, do they also converge? And so this was something that was proved by Shirokov in 2006, so it was already before Winter came up with this, where he proved that this is actually true. So as epsilon goes to zero, so the distance goes to zero, this goes to zero and they converge. Okay, but the problem is we don't really know how fast they converge, and that's kind of what we are looking at. So in order to know how fast you get the convergence, you have to define two auxiliary functions which look a bit incomprehensible at first glance. So it's called n, well, let's say upper arrow, h of the energy, so it sums over all the lambda plus lambda prime in the spectrum of your Hamiltonian that have energy less than e, and it only takes here into account lambda squared. So lambda prime does not really appear here, but you sum over all these lambda primes. Then you have this n lower arrow, where you sum over the same set, but now lambda times lambda prime. And you can show that this quantity is larger than that quantity. And if this limit exists, so this psi here, in the limit as, so this would be now the limit e goes to infinity in that notation, and lambda goes to infinity in that notation. So if this limit exists, then you can define, and it's larger than one, because I told you that this quantity is larger than that quantity, then you can define this eta, which is defined in terms of this psi. And so just to give you an example for the harmonic oscillator, this would be that sum, which you can completely explicitly evaluate. And in the other case, you would get this sum here. And it turns out that this is eta, so because this is, you know, a simple calculus to figure out what these sums are. So in that case, you get that eta is equal to one. And so what we prove is that this means that the rate of convergence in these entropy bounds is actually quite fast. So the rate of convergence you get is, so this eta will appear here. So you have two epsilon. The epsilon was the distance between your states. And you have this term log of e over epsilon appearing here. And so epsilon times log of one over something epsilon, this goes to zero, well, not linearly, but every power e to the alpha, where alpha is less than one, will converge slower than this object, right? So you get actually in infinite dimensions under the conditions that Winter assumed, you get actually a very fast convergence. And similar bounds, so this concept I told you now about the von Neumann entropy, you can also look at other entropies and capacities. And this builds up on work of Shirokov and Winter. So Shirokov worked a lot on these capacities, and Winter in his paper in 2015, he also considers a lot of other entropies. And so our contribution to that is to understand the behavior of this Gibbs state that appears in their bounds. Okay, and time is almost up, so I guess I can finish with my summary. And so say again what we did. So in the first bit of, we saw that we cannot really study uniform convergence of semigroups, so we cannot really study uniformly how fast does a system evolve in infinite dimensions, because the problem is that, at least in general, the system will evolve arbitrarily fast, right? So we have to introduce a certain constraint, and the constraint that we introduced was in the energy. And this led us to these energy constraint Diamond norms, which are the natural tool to get some kind of convergence rates. So to say how fast can a system evolve and so on. And this gave us a much more refined picture of, you know, how fast is quantum evolution. And it turns out that for open quantum systems, the result that you get is not very different from the one that you get for closed systems. And we also saw that using these, so the technique that we are using are these Favart spaces, which are a tool that comes from semigroup theory, and they allow us to get actually better bounds than people before. So in Winter, when he proved his bound, he just did it by, you know, hands-on computations and got his bound. And in the second part, we studied the high energy asymptotics of the Gibbs state. And the reason why we do this is because the Gibbs state, so, is essential in all these entropy and capacity bounds. So based on the work of Winter and Shirokov, where they showed that you can get such bounds under certain assumptions in terms of the entropy of a Gibbs state. Our interest was in understanding, okay, so you know, for small distances between the states, how fast do you converge from, so maybe to say it like that, so if you have state one converges to state two, how fast does the entropy of state one converge to state two? And also, in order to answer these questions, we needed to look at the asymptotics of the Gibbs state entropy, and that's what we did in that part. And okay, and this made us, or this allowed us then to make these bounds that they derived much more quantitative, because before it was only known that you get some kind of continuity, but not really what kind of continuity. Okay, so the result of that talk can be found in that preprint. And yes, then I thank you very much for your attention, and
I'm done. Okay, just take one question only, okay.
Thanks for, hello? Thanks for letting me ask the question. Can you go two slides back, please? Okay, so the last inequality. Often, as you're saying, these bounds are very useful for establishing explicit upper bounds on capacities of channels for which you don't actually know the capacity. And so I guess I have two questions. You might have said it. This upper bound is strictly better than the Shirokov-Winter bound for continuity. Is that correct?
Oh, so the thing is that, maybe to explain it, sorry. The thing is that you see there's this bound by Winter.
Yeah.
This one. Well, the thing is that, so he bounds the entropy of one state and the entropy of another state by 2 times epsilon, so epsilon is the distance of these two states, times another object, which is the entropy of a Gibbs state. This Gibbs state is defined e to the minus beta h over the partition function. So in general, you don't really have an idea what this Gibbs state is. You know, there are only a few examples like the harmonic oscillator where you can compute this. And what we do now is that we try to understand what is exactly the behavior of this Gibbs state as epsilon goes to zero. Okay, so it's not like we prove a new bound, but it's just that we try to understand their bounds, you know, what do they say? Because in general, I don't know, I mean, okay. To me, for example, the only case where I know how to compute this entropy of the Gibbs state is the harmonic oscillator, and that's about it.
Yeah.
So we try to make this quantitative.
I just have another brief question. Can you go back to the next slide?
Okay. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, so what's hiding under the little O of one? Because often when you use these to get explicit bounds for capacity, you want to know exactly what's there. So can you say, like, what's under the little O of one, or is it just some obvious thing?
Okay, so the thing is that this depends very much on the kind of operator you have. So, I mean, okay. You see, I mean, in our bounds here, there's something which is, looks a bit unclear how to evaluate, maybe, which are these functions. But it turns out that these functions, you are only interested in large energy behavior of these functions. And it turns out that the spectrum for a lot of operators, so I don't know, let's say you consider a particle in a box, then you have a Laplacian. Okay, but if you now add, so the energies will scale like n squared. But now if you add a small potential, let's say cosine of x to it, the low-lying eigenvalues will look very different, but the high-energy states will be the same. And it turns out that this behavior, so these quantities don't depend on the low-lying eigenvalues, because I take here the limit of the energy going to infinity. So there's, in mathematics, there's something called Weyl's law, which gives you the asymptotic behavior of a spectrum of an operator. And so depending on what the error rate in this Weyl law is, you get a different, so this gives you very precisely what is this little O of one. So it's not like there's a uniform answer. It's, I don't know, it's not like there's an answer that would hold for every operator, because we have many Hamiltonians. So this is the Gibbs state of an arbitrary Hamiltonian. And so this error can look very different, but it can be found in terms of Weyl's law, basically, what the error in that law, in that mathematical theorem is, if that is.
Thanks.
So maybe we'll take one last question, yeah.
you had these inequalities with h and k, right? These
That's
omega
right.
h restriction. Shouldn't you somehow use absolute value of h squared plus k squared and then the square root to do this combined? There should be one thing which does it both.
Well, the thing is,
in semigroup theory, you just if you have two generators, you just take a squared plus b squared 1/2, and that should do it for both.
Okay, but the thing is that so you're saying why do we in this energy constraint diamond norms, why don't we have
This omega h and omega k which you had before?
That's right.
There should be something which works for both of them simultaneously. Maybe sometimes individually this is better, but you know you have a k there and the h.
Yes, so I mean the thing is in general I will have both, right? I will have a k and an h.
Right.
And now the thing is that but in order to work with this approach, I either need that k is relatively h bounded, which means that k of x norm is less than a constant hx plus beta
but,
x.
But there is an object which is bigger than both of them, and then you have a uniform. There's an object which is bigger than k and h, and then there's one formula which does it for both.
The problem is that we cannot really, so in general, so we cannot really work with this h plus k because, how shall I say, you see these bounds are very similar to the, I mean, I think I understand what you're saying, but it doesn't really come out of the way we try to prove this because, how shall I say, this very much resembles the bound that I showed you for the closed system where we only have an h, right? We don't have a k. Okay. And now when we prove these bounds for the open system, what we do is we try to reduce everything back to the h case where we only have an h and no k. So it's not like we have an approach that tackles everything together.
That's what I was asking.
Which
for.
might be more suitable.
Yeah, I have the feeling there should be something like this. But
that's right. But the thing is that we sort of map the open systems back to the closed systems, if that makes sense.
I hope there's something here.
That's right. But the problem is that you know these operators enter very differently. You see this Hamiltonian. It's IH, so it's you know it's an operator which has spectrum on the imaginary axis, and the other one, they are very different. So it's hard to like combine them together. I think, but I think you're right. It may not be the final answer to that question. Thank you.
Okay, so I guess we're over time. So if you have any more questions, you can ask during the tea break. So let's take the opportunity to thank all the speakers in this session. So thank you.